I'm just going to get right into this because we have so much to talk about in limited time. I'm going to do it this time, all right? This is the Squared Circle here on 90.3 WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College. I am not your host, but I'm one of the co-hosts, Dominic Arbolino, alongside with me, Joe Ritter and Justin Greenberg. I want to get into this right now.
Jeez,
because I'm going to be honest. I understand why you're starting out with Alexa Bliss, and I love the way she did it. Joe is doing her title thing with a...
It's adorable.
...with a sheet of paper. It looks great. But I understand... I like how they did it, but why don't you give other people a chance, please?
Because they know what they got in Alexa Bliss. They know she's a stud.
Great. No, she's great. She is, and I'm not denying that. And I'm going to be honest. I love the way they did it. But how do you not give other people a chance? I'm not complaining about Sasha. Obviously, we all know I'm a Sasha fan. I was upset to not see her win, but I'm used to it.
I will say Sasha took a brutal bump
on the ladder. Yes, she was taking bumps the whole time.
Nah, not really. Just one really... particularly brutal one. I think it was from Ember Moon, who hit her with like a crossbody, and she crashed onto the ladder. And my dad said it best. He looked right at me and went, "How does that not hurt?"
It hurts.
Oh, it definitely hurts. But yeah, you just gotta keep moving on.
Oh, it's insane, though. I think I would just lay there dead.
I always say that too.
I'd pull a Velveteen Dream and just go, and just like lay there.
You know, I always have like sometimes a couple friends come by in terms of like with pay per views or whatever the case is. You know, they're not really the biggest fans of wrestling, but they'll still come by to watch it. Uh-huh. You know, sometimes they'll make fun of like, you know, how like some of it's fake and all. But I was like, look, if we're gonna be taking those hits, we're gonna be down for like 20 to 30 minutes in agony, but they get right back up. So
yeah, I mean, what does help, obviously, is the adrenaline.
Yeah.
When you got the crowd, you know, there. I'm sure if you were doing this by yourself, you'd kind of just be laying on the ground, but you got 10,000 people screaming. It kind of gets you up. But what are we going to be talking about today, guys? Anything else you want to complain about, Dom?
No.
You just want to give people a chance?
Look, we'll get to it when we go over the Money in the Bank card.
We're going to go over
stuff.
All the Money in the Bank.
NXT Takeover.
We're talking about NXT Takeover later on. I didn't get to talk about Dominion last week that I watched, which I definitely want to talk about really quickly because
you can mention it.
They're heralding it as one of the greatest matches ever to take place in wrestling happened. So I just want to talk about it really quickly. I know you guys didn't really watch it.
I didn't get a chance to see it yet.
No. But I want to talk about it just quickly because we can't not talk about it. We are a wrestling talk show called The Squared Circle.
All right. Yes. I think we should start with Money in the Bank. We'll start going through the card.
Not NXT?
No.
No, we'll start with Money in the Bank.
Yeah. All right.
And then NXT. All right, I understand NXT was the better show.
Best for last. Save the best for last.
All right, so I actually came home at around 8:15 last night, so I didn't get a chance to see, you know, the pre-show or the first couple of matches. I read what happened, so you guys are gonna have to take over.
That's okay. Fine.
Obviously, the pre-show. Opening match, SmackDown Tag Team Championship. The Bludgeon Brothers defeated Luke Gallows and Carl Anderson via pinfall to retain the titles. We all saw that happening, right?
Yes, but this was actually, you know what? I saw it happening, but it was a much better match, 10 times better match than I thought it was going to be. Carl Anderson and Luke Gallows actually put up a fight, which you really haven't seen with any other competitors against the Bludgeon Brothers, so I'm glad to see actually, you know, have more of a match with these two. And I think this is just pretty much leading to eventually, you know, when Sanity, I think it's going to be this Tuesday, is going to get finally show up with Nikki Cross because I think she's done in NXT now. And I think that's what they've been waiting for, and I think they're going to be the tag team to eventually, you know, knock down the Bludgeon Brothers because they're saying how they've beaten every tag team on SmackDown and nobody else can beat them. So you'll have a new tag team show up, which obviously has a lot of people love Sanity. They were very loved in NXT, so I could definitely see that happening. But in terms of the match, it was definitely, I think it was a quality match. There was actually moments where I thought Luke Gallows and Carl Anderson had a chance to win.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought overall it was a good match. It was definitely a better showing than I thought they were going to put on.
Joe, you saw the match?
Yeah, I thought it was a really good match. A lot of good back and forth. They had a lot of good segments that went on between Anderson and Harper. And even Rowan wasn't that bad.
Yeah, Rowan's still garbage, but
people give Rowan a lot of garbage and they say he's really bad, and he really isn't that good, but he looked pretty good, and he's looking a lot better. I think Harper is getting the best out of Rowan.
I just wish
now.
Harper would get that solo run, but we've discussed that.
We'll get there one day.
Yeah, you know, they always talked about Gallows and Anderson being this legendary Japanese team, you know. I haven't seen anything, you know, really, really good since they've been in the company for almost 2 years at this point.
Yeah. And I mean, they did have the Rock tag team titles.
But it's so unforgettable. What's like that one like Gallows and Anderson match? If you were to be like, you need to watch these guys.
No,
I can't think of it. It's just...
you got to go back to Japan to think about it, really.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know why that is, why they aren't able to translate it to the American television. I don't know if, you know, they're held back and they're not allowed to do certain moves. I know know the style in Japan is much different. It's a much, you know, more stiff style, as I'm sure we'll talk about with the whole Dominion pay-per-view, just how different it is. I don't know if that's what's holding them back. I think they're charismatic. I think, you know, they're able to both speak on the mic. They got an interesting look, and I don't think they're not talented. I think it also might have to do the fact that Vince McMahon has never been a fan of tag team wrestling. You know, any podcast I listen to, you know, that kind of has the insider of
what
wrestling.
We're the only podcast.
Yeah! We're not. There's actually a lot of great wrestling podcasts out there. So I would recommend anybody to not only listen to us, which when we get podcasts, which you could check it out, Squared Circle, just type Squared Circle 90.3 into any of your podcast apps. But Bruce Pritchard's got a great podcast. He also has a show on the WWE Network. Eric Bischoff's got a great podcast. And Tony Schiavone.
But nobody's better than us.
Nobody's better than us. We're the bee's knees. So let's head to the actual pay-per-view. This was shocking. I would have thought that, you know, they would continue this feud, but it looks like Daniel Bryan defeated Big Cass via submission. I mean, how does a guy like Big Cass, you know, come back? He's this, you know, monster heel. He eliminates Bryan at the World's Greatest Royal Rumble. And I guess it's, you know, backstage politics, but, like, he's been completely buried at this point.
Well, here's the thing with me. I'm going to be honest. I thought, like I said, I predicted Bryan to win, but I feel like Big Cass, it was definitely possible for him to take the W. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I like how this match played out. I thought it had a couple of good spots. And then, again, you know, this is a better showing than I thought was actually going to happen. This match went for about, I think, like 20 to 22 minutes.
Really?
Like, anywhere in that range. Yeah,
I'll have to check it out.
No, it was a long match.
Yeah, Bryan's my favorite wrestler in the company. I think Big Cass, you know,
Big Cass is doing a good job as a heel. Yeah. He's doing a great job as a heel. Comes out with this stupid thing, and everyone booed the hell out of him. It was great.
He's got good heat.
He's doing good as a heel, but again, he doesn't have that edge to, you know, I feel like the reason why the creative team did not put him over yet is because I feel like he doesn't have that edge to put him over yet.
And also, the backstage stuff, too.
Yeah, the backstage stuff as well, of course, that adds to it. And again, I feel like you can't have Daniel Bryan, like, lose his first feud back. I feel like you need him to win it.
You could, you know, he's already won like two of the matches, right? But
at the same time, it's Big Cass. But
you know, Bryan's a made man. Daniel Bryan could lose five matches on the next five pay-per-views, and you know, he could come back in December and win the world title. To me, he's a guy that, you know, no matter win, lose, or draw, he's going to be over. So they could have. I know you were saying you want to make new stars. If you have Big Cass beat the crap out of Daniel Bryan, boom, you got a top heel on the SmackDown brand. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you could have made it, but listen, like I said, I'm a huge Bryan fan. I'm hoping this leads to a possible Bryan versus AJ match. Let's do it at SummerSlam, perhaps?
Maybe.
Main event SummerSlam?
Definitely not main event.
I think so.
I don't think it's going to be main eventing.
Vince isn't going to do that. Yeah, Vince's boy, Brock Lesnar, will be the main event.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
If you're paying him as much money as he's going
to
pay him.
For other reasons that we'll get to, let's continue with the Money in the Bank card, and then we'll actually get to that.
This match, I saw...
I think we should just skip it, honestly.
Some clips of it.
This is bad.
Bobby Lashley versus Sami Zayn. It was a squash. Sami does the best job he can, but it's a squash match. That's literally all that happened here.
I saw the pinfall.
It's just so unfortunate.
That you saw the best part of the match, then.
Did he pin him with his foot?
No, with his hand.
Just one hand, like a nonchalant cover.
Yep.
I mean, I feel like that was the only way to actually do this match, though, because if you look at Bobby Lashley compared to Sami Zayn, I mean, you just see the dominance over him.
You can't do this match.
No, I don't think you can, and I think it's unfortunate to see what they're doing with Sami Zayn on the main roster, because you look back, actually, before NXT TakeOver, I was at my friend Jake's house, and he's obviously been a guest on the show before, and we were just going back in NXT and watching some stuff, and we watched the match where he beat Neville to win the NXT Championship, and then you had everyone come out and celebrate with him, because he was the face.
And then Owens attacked him.
That was such a great moment, and it was awesome, mm-hmm. and it led to such great stuff in NXT with Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens, and you just think that Sami Zayn right now is getting wasted.
I don't think he's getting wasted. I think, you know, he's on TV. He has prominent time. Listen, he's not winning, and he wasn't going to win against a returning Bobby Lashley, but whenever, you know, I watch Raw, Zayn's like, you know, usually like at the top of an hour, which is, you know, primetime television, like he'll be on at 9 o'clock doing his stuff with Bobby Lashley. I think it's, you know, awful stuff, but I don't think, again, I don't think it's Zayn's fault.
But he has so much potential.
Of course he does.
He was so good coming up, and then...
I'm going to say, let's just drop it, because I don't know if this is breaking, Dom?
I think it's going on right now.
I think they just announced this. Breaking news, NXT UK is going to be its own separate show. They're going to be doing a new NXT show.
I don't know how I think
all
about
UK
that.
Wrestlers.
You know,
that's what it looks like.
You know, you don't never want to oversaturate the market with wrestling. So now you have NXT on Wednesdays. You got, you know, Raw, SmackDown. You got your, you know, potential potentially you could have a wrestling show on every day of the week.
Yeah, but you know what?
It's not good.
It was just announced because you have like they have like a tournament going on right now.
The NXT
in the UK.
UK Championship right now.
Yeah, so that's what's going on right now. And then it was just announced that yes, they are getting their own brand.
Which I also have some quotes from Triple H. We'll talk about later on, but that's breaking. That's pretty cool. If Triple H is in charge of it, I mean, I'm down for it. Triple
Look,
H has been
anything Triple H
killing
H
it with NXT
is going to be great. I mean, he should definitely. I think he should definitely take over, hopefully, the main roster soon. I know it's not going to happen for a little bit until Vince is done, but
I'm sure, you know, Vince McMahon will literally be working till the day he dies, and I would expect him to live for another 20 years. So we're going to have a lot of bad booking, especially when the dementia kicks in. Yeah.
So let's go to some good a good booked match, and I thought it was actually a good match on Money in the Bank. Seth Rollins and Elias. I liked this match. I thought Elias put on a great performance. I thought he
like
was
always.
Selling it pretty good. You know, no, usually Elias isn't that great in the ring.
Oh, wait, you said Elias? Excuse me.
Yeah,
I thought you said Rollins.
Usually Elias isn't that great in the ring.
Yeah,
he got some great heat beforehand. You know, the crowd, obviously, they are definitely behind this guy. Seth Rollins, another guy who's just charismatic getting into the ring. But I thought that Elias put on a good performance. Maybe Seth brought it out of him, or maybe he brought it out of Seth. Who knows?
But I would think vice versa. I've been impressed with very much Elias has done in the ring, like you said. But as far as, you know, charisma and being able to get heat, and you know, I'm a big fan of Elias, and but Rollins is such a good in-ring performer that I caught. You know, the first match I caught was the Money in the Bank women's match. I didn't see this. Yeah. Is this something I should go back and watch, or is this kind of standard?
This wasn't like a 5-star like crazy match of a lifetime. It was a good match.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they did a lot of, you know, it was more wrestling than a spot fest, and then it turned into a spot fest. And Elias, you know, it was a really good spot that they were trying to say that Rollins' leg is a mess and that, you know, he's having problems, and he did his really crappy dive, and Elias turned it into a really good little sequence.
I think it's kind of aggravating how, like, when you have a match with Seth Rollins nowadays, like, if they want the competitor to have an actual chance, like, something eventually happens to Rollins' knee that he tore his ACL and or whatever he did with it, like, they're still having that, like, comeback to bite him in some matches where I feel like
it's a little dragged.
Like, I understand that when you have an injury like that, it will affect you for the rest of your life, but I feel like they're doing it way too often to be realistic and believable.
I mean, honestly, it is realistic. I had bad surgery, and I still feel it every day, and I wake up.
I understand.
So it's like, there's like problems like that. Like, if you tore your ACL as bad as they say he did.
Yeah, I understand.
And for as long as he did, you know, you're definitely going to feel pain in it, especially when you're doing, you know, wrestling and, you know, you're combative in quotes here. But it's like, I could see them selling it, and you know what? They sold it really well, and I think they put a good side. It ended, just so you know, Justin, and everyone else out there who didn't quite see it, that because it's hard to see from the camera angles that Rollins was pulling Elias's tights.
Yes.
So Elias was doing it to Rollins, which you get. Yeah, he's a heel. He's going to do that kind of stuff. But then Rollins did it to him to seal the deal on a win.
I see that.
And
okay.
I think there's two ways that this, you know, feud can possibly either keep going or what's going to happen from it. Where the first one I have that I feel like it can continue to Extreme Rules, where eventually there'll be like a no DQ match or something like that, where I think that will, you can see a Dean Ambrose return there, where you have Elias will finally win a belt. He'll have the Intercontinental Championship for SummerSlam. Then you can have Seth Rollins versus Dean Ambrose without a belt at SummerSlam, because that's obviously going to build up a lot of heat. I feel like a heel Dean Ambrose is the way he should come back. I feel like that's perfect. He's been boring as a face.
Yeah, and he is a good heel, because, you know, we saw him in the Shield, and I watched him before he got to the WWE, and he was Johnny Moxley, and he was doing some really good stuff.
And he changed up his look, too, because they had him at the Vegas Golden Knights game when they were in the playoffs. And you saw him.
He had an earring.
Yeah, he had an earring.
Yikes. Better watch out.
He, like, shaved his head basically down to, like, a crew cut, like...
It's interesting.
It was an interesting look for him.
And then
he looked like a redhead, too.
Yeah.
Weird.
The other possibility I could see happening from it is that, obviously, Justin, I don't know if you noticed this, because like you said, you didn't really catch this, but Joe, maybe you did, where after the match, you kind of had like the camera stay with them for like a little bit, like after the match was over, and personally, I was thinking, oh, Elias is definitely going to attack Rollins for the way he won, and then
you think Elias is turning face?
I think you can
double flip here?
I don't know about a double flip.
Seth used the cheap way to win. And
yeah, but he's so over as a babyface, yeah, so there's no need to turn.